Simon & Schuster Audio presents What Would Reagan Do? Life Lessons from the Last Great President by Chris Christie with Ellis Henneken. Read by Danny Campbell.
This book is dedicated to my wife and lifelong partner, Mary Pat, the person who has always believed in me and shared with me our faith in our family, our country, and our responsibility to try to make both the best they can be. Introduction. First time. You never forget the first time. Freshman year, University of Delaware. I was finally out of my parents' house and trying to turn a cramped dorm room double, outfitted to hold three of us, into a place of my own. That took some ingenuity when the chief design feature was a trio of stiff metal twin beds with thin, creaky mattresses, longer but no wider or any more comfortable than army cots. Welcome to college life, young man. I turned 18 that September, which still didn't make me legal at the Deer Park Tavern or the Stone Balloon or Klondike Kate's. The drinking age in Delaware was 20 at the time, though I have to say I don't remember much carding at any of the bars near campus. But I'd be old enough to vote in the November election. And I damn sure wasn't going to miss what felt to me that fall like a golden opportunity. I was definitely more conservative than some of my new classmates, many of whom seemed to think that nuclear power was a dire threat to the planet, and that big business loved nothing more than dumping pollution into the rivers and streams. But I'd been class president all 4 years at Livingston High in New Jersey. And I hoped to get active in student government at Delaware. I was always up for a spirited debate. I already knew I'd be majoring in political science. I remembered 4 years earlier, in the summer between 8th and 9th grades, sitting at home with my parents and watching every night of the Democratic convention from Madison Square Garden as an obscure governor from Georgia named Jimmy Carter nailed down the nomination against a big field of higher-profile Washington types. Then it was the Republicans' turn in Kansas City. Former California Governor Ronald Reagan almost snatched his party's nomination from Gerald Ford, who had become president after Richard Nixon resigned because of Watergate. The soaring oratory, the backroom deals, the floor reporters jamming microphones into the faces of delegates from all over the country. Every action-packed minute of it made me think, this is so cool. The last night of the Republican convention, after Ford had already accepted the nomination, they called Reagan back to the podium. He delivered a speech filled with so much passion and optimism. It almost sounded like Reagan, not Ford, was the candidate who'd won. I believe the Republican Party has a platform that is a banner of bold, unmistakable colors with no pale pastel shades, Reagan told the spellbound delegates. What the Democrats were offering, he said, was nothing but a revamp and a reissue and a rerunning of a late, late show of the thing that we have been hearing from them for the last 40 years. My father pointed out that Reagan's speech hadn't exactly endorsed Ford, but the former California governor's stirring words and his natural delivery made voting for a Republican sound exciting and something to be proud of, like a team you'd want to play on. I could tell Reagan had the whole convention hall right in the palm of his hands. It was just after Reagan finished that I turned to my parents, who were sitting next to each other on the couch, and announced to them, I'm a Republican. To me, the Republicans seemed to put their faith in people, while the Democrats believed most of all in government. It was a simple distinction, but to me, a very big one. So here I was, 4 years later, finally old enough to vote. By then, Gerald Ford was ancient news, having lost to Jimmy Carter. Ronald Reagan, who'd made such an impression on me and a lot of other people the last time around, was now the 1980 Republican presidential nominee. This time, he'd cruised past a lineup of other Republican hopefuls, including former CIA Director George Bush, who had now joined the ticket as Reagan's running mate. Carter was back, asking for a second term. To 18-year-old me, the choice was obvious. Carter seemed like a nice enough man, but he clearly wasn't up to the job of president. My high school years had been filled with bad news from Washington. The economy was tanking. Prices kept going up. For a while there, you could buy gas only on certain days of the week, and they kept messing around with daylight saving time. All around the world, America was coming up short. The Soviet Union kept causing trouble, doing things like invading Afghanistan, which provoked a boycott by the United States of the 1980 Olympics. But the worst of it might have been Iran, where a militant gang of heavily armed students were holding 52 American hostages and refusing to let them go. Clearly, the University of Tehran had some extracurricular groups we didn't have at Delaware. And President Carter didn't have a clue what to do about it. Reagan was different, very different. For one thing, he seemed focused and confident. He also knew what he stood for, and he laid it all out. He wanted to cut taxes, make the economy stronger, let America produce more of its own energy, and not take any crap from our enemies. That all sounded good to me. Unlike Carter, who mumbled and meandered, Reagan could express all this clearly and eloquently in a way that a lot of people could relate to, and not just conservatives. He was one of those politicians who, even if you disagreed with him, exuded a down-to-earth decency that made people think he was an okay guy. He'd been a governor and a movie star and the president of the Actors Union in Hollywood. But he still seemed to grasp what real people were going through. The way he talked, he didn't seem to look down on anyone. That first year in college, getting back and forth to New Jersey was a major hassle for me. I had my own car, a 1971 burnt orange Camaro with a black vinyl roof, a great ride to have as a high school senior. But Delaware freshmen weren't allowed to keep a car on campus, so the Camaro sat in my parents' driveway. To get home, I had to board a bus in front of Rhodes Pharmacy near campus on East Main Street and ride to the Port Authority bus terminal in New York City, then transfer to the DeCamp 77 bus to Livingston. That could take hours. So, as election day neared, I decided that my first vote for president was going to be absentee. It was a complicated process, more complicated than I imagined. First, I ordered an absentee ballot, and when it arrived, I sat at the plain wooden desk in my dorm room, 208 Harrington Hall E, and filled in the little box next to the Republican ticket, Reagan and Bush, and the 17 electors who stood for them in New Jersey. I folded the sheet like the instruction said to, put it inside the security envelope, signed and dated the outside of the envelope, sealed the envelope, put that envelope into the prepaid return envelope, and finally dropped the package in the mail to the Essex County Board of Elections in New Jersey. I was super careful. I didn't want to screw it up. Once the ballot was in the mail, I felt like I had done something really important, like I really was on the way to being an adult. I was proud to be part of the presidential election, proud to help Ronald Reagan. I hoped we'd have a better country as a result. My vote wasn't enough to deliver liberal Essex County. Carter was ahead there. But Reagan won New Jersey and its 17 electoral votes, 1,546,557 to 1,147,364. And one of those Reagan votes was mine. It wasn't a close election. Reagan swept into the White House in a 44-state landslide. A lot of people must have been feeling the same way I was. And given all the things that happened next, I have never regretted, not for one little second, the vote I cast from my dorm room that day. I've voted hundreds of times since then, including several times for myself. That was exciting. But I have never been prouder about a vote than in the fall of 1980, when I cast that absentee ballot for Ronald Reagan. Even now, I am still learning lessons from that man and the many examples he set for us. All of us can. He really did articulate what was special and powerful about America. To a remarkable degree, he turned his core conservative principles.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.